In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Loving Heavenly Father, we praise you, we thank you, we bless you, we honor you and glorify you. Thank you, Father, for another wonderful and blessed day that you have given each one of us. Today, Lord, as we gather together, you are going to teach us something so beautiful. Something, Lord, that you have given to each one of us who believe. The gift of understanding. The gift to able to understand your word, to have a practical working knowledge of your word. So that, Lord, as believers, we can live the victorious life that Jesus has already obtained for us. Today, Spirit of God, as you take complete control of this class, I ask you to take complete control of all my faculties as well. My heart, my mind, my lips, my tongue, my vocal cords. Nothing of me, everything of you. And as I share the word, make this teaching, Lord, simple, easy. Make it practical for us to understand. So that applying these truths in our day-to-day life, we can live the victorious life. Spirit of God, you are the best teacher. You are the one who reminds us of all that we have learned so far. You are the one, Holy Spirit, who brings to our memory, who brings to us and helps us to recall everything that we are learning each day, everything that we have planted with the Word of God in our heart. Today, once again, Spirit of God, through all that we have learned so far, take our understanding to a different level so that we can apply with understanding and live the victorious life that Jesus has promised us. We thank you and we praise you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. So my brothers and sisters, a warm welcome to each one of you. Today we are going to reflect on the gospel of the day from Mark chapter 8, verses 14 to 21. Mark chapter 8, verses 14 to 21. And you know, my brothers and sisters, today's gospel is after Jesus has performed the miracle of multiplying 7 loaves and a little fish and feeding 4,000 people who were hungry. You know, yesterday we learned from what Jesus had already told us about hardness of heart. Because Jesus asked his disciples a few questions and yet the disciples were finding it so difficult to understand. But today, my brothers and sisters, Jesus has now taken his disciples and gone on the boat across to some place. And now we see yesterday from the last verse that we read in verse number 13, I believe. In verse number 10, Jesus, along with his disciples, after he has done that miracle, he goes across to the other side. He goes on to the east side, the same place where he had healed the demoniac. And you know, today when he's on the boat with his disciples, Jesus begins by telling the disciples about something which is going to help each one of us. So we're going to take today's gospel from Mark chapter 8, verses 14 to 21. So I'll read verse number 14. Now the disciples had forgotten to bring any bread, and they had only 1 loaf with them in the boat. You know, my brothers and sisters, this verse tells us that one of the disciples, or maybe more than one of them, was given the responsibility to take care of things like food, take care of the requirements of the ministry. Because, you know, when Jesus' ministry was taking place, somebody would have had to take care of the food ministry. Somebody would have to carry the food for them. Somebody would have to carry water for them. Remember, Jesus and his disciples were human beings. They were not people who would not feel hungry. They would not be people who would not feel thirsty. They felt tired. They felt hungry. They felt thirsty. So there was somebody among the group who would have been given that responsibility to take care of the food. And obviously, he had forgotten to do his assignment of bringing the food. And Jesus wouldn't handle these things. Jesus was in charge of the ministry of preaching the word of God. But you know, my brothers and sisters, if Jesus had to handle the food ministry, the water ministry, the transport ministry, all the ministries he had to handle, Jesus would have simply been like a one-man show. He would have been totally burnt out. Jesus didn't handle all these things by himself. When it came to multiplying the food, he only helped to multiply it by performing the miracle. That's what we saw in Mark chapter 6 verses 35 to 44 when he multiplied 5 loaves and 2 fish. And also in Mark chapter 8 verses 1 to 9 which we saw Jesus feeding the 4,000 people. So Jesus was involved in the preaching, the teaching, and he would also do the miracles and multiplication. But carrying the food was not Jesus' ministry. So even Jesus had physical needs, and he delegated the responsibility for providing the food and the water to others. He did not want to do it on his own. And you know, my brothers and sisters, this shows us that Jesus was an awesome leader. He was an awesome leader. Why? A good leader is one who knows how to delegate his job so that he can be very effective. If that leader wants to do the food ministry, the water ministry, the transport ministry, the preaching ministry, he wants to do everything. Do you think that leader will be very effective? He'll be involved with everybody's affairs. His goal, his focus will be distracted. And Jesus would also delegate all his work, which was not related to ministry, which was not related to preaching and teaching, to his disciples, who would do the food and the water and arrange all the other arrangements at the site. You know, my brothers and sisters, any leader who cannot delegate will never be a good, effective leader. We must remember that, especially in our own families. Say the father and the mother. If they themselves are going to do everything and they got children whom they are never going to ask them to do anything because the children don't want to help the parents, what is going to happen to the mother at the end of the day? What's going to happen to the father at the end of the day? What is going to happen to the parents? They'll be irritable, they'll be so angry, and they will never be able to be effective. I'm just talking about leadership in our own homes. It is important for the parents to delegate some job to their children. It's important for the parents to delegate some, you know, the washing of the dishes, to clean the house, in order to do some groceries, because it's a training ground for the children. And you know, my brothers and sisters, we as children will always learn good leadership from our own parents. There are so many parents today who will slog it out, and at the end of the day, they don't even have a time to sit with their family and fellowship with one another. Why? Because they have been involved throughout the day, working, cleaning, cooking, buying. Everything has been done by one man, and especially it is usually the mothers who love their children, love their family to the point that they do everything. And it is important that with the parents, the father and the mother united together can start delegating, can start showing that role to the children, by which the children also can learn to take responsibility so that family can be effective. You know, my brothers and sisters, in the miracle of the multiplication of the 7 loaves that we read in Mark chapter 8, this very chapter, in verses 1 to 9, I believe. Hear what happens. The disciples, after Jesus had fed the whole multitude, they had collected 7 basketfuls of fragments of the leftover that were after the people had eaten. And they had actually collected those baskets and kept, but they had not carried them with them away. They had just left them there, or probably they had given it to somebody. You know, Jesus' ministry involved a lot of work. Many times we look at Jesus' ministry, he preached, he taught, he performed all the miracles, but there were a lot of people who were working behind the scenes. There were a lot of women who were also providing from their own resources for providing food for Jesus and his disciples. It's given in the book of Matthew. Many of the women, like, you know, Mary Magdalene, after she was cured, then Mary, the mother of James, and there were so many of Susanna, all these women in the Bible, they were the ones who were doing a lot of work of providing food and doing a lot of work which is not mentioned in the ministry of Jesus. And you know, my brothers and sisters, please understand, usually it is the preacher or the teacher who's on the pulpit who's actually preaching the word of God. But you know, my brothers and sisters, there are a lot of people in ministry who do a lot of work who are never seen in front of the camera. They are never seen on the screen. It's only the preacher who is seen. For example, you know, between my wife and myself, when we are sharing, she's never the one who's seen on the screen. But you know, she's the one who sets up this computer. She sees that everything is in order. She sees the scriptures. She keeps all the things ready. She checks the internet connection. Today I miss her because she's not there. But she's the one who's keeping everything ready so that that particular job of, you know, transmission can go wonderfully well. She also, you know, gets involved with my glass of water sometimes. She prepares a cup of tea and keeps it so that, you know, it helps me while I'm sharing the word. So there is so much of work that is there of ministry, which is not only teaching and preaching, but there is so much of work involved behind the scenes, which involves for that ministry to be very effective. Verse number 15. And he cautioned them, saying, watch out, beware of the yeast of the Pharisees and the yeast of Herod. You know, my brothers and sisters, Jesus is talking to the disciples and he's telling them, watch out, he's saying, beware of the yeast of the Pharisees and the yeast of Herod. You know, this is also recorded, this particular scripture is also recorded in the book of Matthew, in Matthew chapter 16, verses 6 to 12. I just want to read there what Matthew says in Matthew chapter 16, verses 6 to 12. You know, it says, in Matthew chapter 16, verses 6 to 12, it says, when the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground. Sorry, this is Matthew 16. Matthew 16. Okay. Jesus said to them, watch out and beware of the yeast of the Pharisees and Sadducees. They said to one another, it is because we have brought no bread. And becoming aware of it, Jesus said, you of little faith, why are you talking about having no bread? Do you still not perceive? Do you not remember the five loaves for the 5,000 and how many baskets you gathered? Or the seven loaves for the 4,000 and how many baskets you gathered? And how you failed to perceive that I was not speaking about bread? Beware of the yeast of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. You know, my brothers and sisters, Jesus writes, you know, Matthew writes that Jesus was speaking of the doctrine of the Pharisees and Sadducees. When Jesus said to them, watch out and beware of the yeast of the Pharisees, beware of the yeast of Herod, Jesus was talking to them, especially when you read Matthew's gospel, he was talking to them about the doctrine, the false doctrine of the Pharisees and Sadducees. And you know, my brothers and sisters, evil doctrine, listen to this very carefully, is going to set many of us free. Evil doctrine is like a yeast. You know, a little bit of yeast is added to the dough. If you go to the baker, they don't only mix the flour, but they add a little yeast to that to sort of increase the size of the bread. The bread sort of raises up, just a little yeast, and it makes such a huge difference in the dough. And in the same way, evil and false doctrines goes a long way to pollute everything and anyone who comes in contact with it. Please remember this. False doctrines are like evil doctrines. They are just like yeast. The yeast has got an effect on the dough, making it rise. In the same way, false doctrines have got the ability to pollute everything and anybody who starts following that. You know, my brothers and sisters, anything, listen to this again, anything that is not confirmed in the written word of God and affirmed by the Holy Spirit is evil and false doctrines. You can write it down so that you can go back to scripture and remind yourself every day of your life. Anything that is not confirmed in the written word of God and affirmed by the Holy Spirit is evil and false doctrine. And there is a lot of false doctrine in the church today, in the body of Christ. And this has kept people in bondage and it has kept people under Satan's grip. You know, my brothers, this is a very dangerous and a very, very evil situation in the body of Christ today. There is a lot of false doctrine. There is a lot of evil doctrine which is contrary to the word of God, which has not been confirmed by the Holy Spirit, which has just been handed over, just like the traditions, the rituals and customs which the Pharisees were transmitting to the people, which had no real life. And that doctrine which they were following was resulting in the people losing their interest in religion. They were fed up with religion, and now they could see hope in Jesus Christ. You know, my brothers and sisters, please understand this. If a false doctrine is given and it can never be confirmed or affirmed by the Holy Spirit or by the written word of God, there is nothing from the Holy Spirit or nothing from the divine that is ever going to confirm that. And when people begin to follow it because it is convenient, now there is going to be an entry of the enemy. Those people are going to be kept in bondage. And therefore, brothers and sisters, it is very important for us to be 100% sure whether we are hearing something is coming from the Holy Spirit, is coming from the written word of God. I also want to tell you one more thing, my brothers and sisters. In John chapter 6, verse 63, Jesus says, "My word is spirit, my word is life." You know, the word of God is the Holy Spirit. Please understand, the word is not one, the spirit is not one, and the father is not one. It is one God in three persons. So the word of God, the Holy Spirit, the Heavenly Father, Jesus, all of them are in perfect harmony, are in perfect unity, because it is the one God in three persons. So the word of God is Jesus himself, the word that became flesh. And the word of God has to be always confirmed by the Holy Spirit. If the Holy Spirit doesn't confirm that word, it is definitely a false doctrine. And a false doctrine today has affected the body of Christ. It has kept people in bondage. People are not having any relationship with the Lord. They are being deceived by false doctrines because it becomes very convenient to believe false doctrines. Verse number 16. Mark chapter 8, verse number 16. Okay. They said to one another, "It is because we have no bread." You know, my brothers and sisters, Jesus' disciples were always missing the point. Every time Jesus tried to explain to his disciples something, they always were misunderstanding. They were always missing the point. They were always not able to be in harmony with what Jesus was teaching them. Everything that Jesus showed them, they were always confused. They would always go on the quiet and ask him. For example, when Jesus preached the parable of the sower and the seed, just like all the crowds that were there, the disciples also did not understand. So what they did, they were embarrassed to ask their master in front of the whole crowd. When they were indoors, they asked their master, "Please, can you explain to us the parable of the sower and the seed?" And that's the time Jesus said to them, "Are you also without understanding? How will you understand all the other parables? How can you become my disciples?" So that was the time when Jesus explained the sower and the seed to them when he was with them indoors. Another example, when Jesus, the disciples were, one father brought the his son to the disciples to cast out the evil spirit. You know what happened, my brothers and sisters? When the evil spirit could not be cast out, the father of that boy, he comes up to Jesus and he says, "I brought my son to your disciples. They could not cast that evil spirit." So Jesus finally cast that evil spirit. But when they went indoors, they asked Jesus the question, "Lord, how is that we could not cast it out? We had cast only the evil spirits before, but how is that we couldn't cast it?" And Jesus told them, "It's not because you have a problem with your faith. It is because of your unbelief. You were so much focused with your senses. You were focused with what you were seeing with your eyes, what that evil spirit was doing to that boy. And as a result, you were not able to operate by faith, and you operated in unbelief, and that evil spirit could not go out. You know, my brothers and sisters, the disciples were continuously misunderstanding Jesus until the day of Pentecost, when everything changed. When the Holy Spirit came on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit reminded them everything that Jesus had told them. He began to bring to their memory all that Jesus had told them. He began to teach them again what Jesus had already told them during his time of his ministry on earth. And now the disciples sort of, you know, just began to recall everything. The Holy Spirit gave them that understanding. And now those disciples were never the same again. Every spiritual truth became so clear to them because of the presence of the Holy Spirit. And you know, my brothers and sisters, you and I today who belong to the new covenant, you and I who have Christ on the inside of us, our spirit has been sealed with the Holy Spirit. We also, like those disciples on the day of Pentecost, have also got that understanding. We can have the Holy Spirit, our helper, our advocate, our guide, to also give us those same truths, so that we also can now have the understanding, have the practical working knowledge of the word, and now receive that victory that Jesus has won for us. Verse number 18. Do you have eyes and fail to see? I'm sorry, it is verse number 17. I missed it. And becoming aware of it, Jesus said to them, why are you talking about having no bread? Do you still not perceive or understand? Are your hearts hardened? You know, my brothers and sisters, when Jesus is telling them to take care of the yeast of Herod and the Pharisees, the disciples are already talking about food. They are thinking about their stomachs. And Jesus is saying to them, Are you not able to understand? Aren't you not able to perceive? Are your hearts so hardened? Haven't you seen the miracle that I've done? You know, my brothers and sisters, just a few days before this incident which took place on the boat, these disciples, because of their hardened heart, couldn't recognize Jesus walking on the water. In fact, they were amazed when they saw Jesus walking on the water. And you know, my brothers and sisters, we saw yesterday what a hardened heart does. It produces spiritual retardation. You know, these disciples had seen Jesus performing a miracle with 5 loaves and 2 fish and feeding crowds of people. Just a few days again, he had fed with 7 loaves, 4,000 people, again, supernaturally with performing a miracle. And yet these same disciples, now they are talking about not having bread. Jesus is not talking to them about food that is physical food. He's talking to them about the yeast, the doctrine of the Pharisees, which was false, which was evil, because that evil doctrine and that evil, that evil teaching of the Pharisees was going to pollute them and affect them. And Jesus was warning his disciples. He says, be careful about their doctrine. Be careful of what they are preaching, because that preaching of theirs, if you take it in, you are going to be spiritually retarded. I just spoke to you a short while ago. What an evil doctrine, or a doctrine which is not confirmed in the Word of God or not affirmed by the Holy Spirit, can do to us. It can keep us in bondage. It can keep us completely under the yoke of Satan. And therefore, brothers and sisters, in order to be set free, what does Jesus say in John 8:32? He says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. You know, my brothers and sisters, the truth is the word of God. When we know the truth, when we understand the truth, when we have a practical working knowledge of the truth of the word of God, that's the time we will be set free from our bondage. We'll be set free from that religious spirit. We will now begin to experience a relationship with the living God. You know, my brothers and sisters, please understand this. Today's gospel should be an eye-opener to many of us, because many of us think that whatever has been told, whatever we hear, even if it is told by somebody in a high position, is the gospel truth. It can never be the gospel truth unless it is in the written word of God and unless it is affirmed and confirmed by the Holy Spirit. Because Jesus's word is truth. He said, you shall know the truth. You shall know my word, and the word and the truth shall set you free. Verse number 18. What does he say? Do you have eyes and fail to see? Do you have ears and fail to hear? And do you not remember? You know, my brothers and sisters, here is Jesus. He's not talking about the physical ears and physical eyes of the disciples. They had physical eyes. They had physical ears. He was speaking about being able to see and hear with the heart. You know, my brothers and sisters, unless we are able to look at this written word of God with our heart, because the gospel has not been written to our brains. Many a times we are reading this gospel with our intelligence, with our brains. The Bible has not been written to our brains. It has not been written to our intelligence. It has been written to our heart. And therefore, when Jesus is saying to them, do you not have eyes? Do you not have ears? Don't you remember what I did for you? Why is he saying that, my brothers and sisters? Because he wants them to hear with their heart. And that's what Saint Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 7. You know, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 7, the word of God says, we do not walk by sight, but we walk by faith. Do not walk by sight. Do not walk by, you know, don't go about your life by what somebody said, what you're seeing with your eyes, what the newspapers are saying about the pandemic. Don't get focused by your senses. Be focused on the word of God. Keep your eyes on this written word of God. And you know, my brothers and sisters, it is only when we keep our eyes on the word of God that that word of God is talking to our hearts. And as a result, the faith that has been built on the inside of us by the renewing of our mind is taking us from glory to glory. We have seen that when we spoke last week about the difference between the old covenant and the new covenant. And you know, my brothers and sisters, when we begin to understand which covenant we belong to, that we belong to a new covenant, that we can enter the very presence of God, to the throne of mercy and grace, now we can only enter that throne of mercy and grace by looking at this written word of God. You cannot enter the throne of God physically. God is in heaven. We are here on earth. But in the spirit, we can enter his very presence through the written word of God, through the spirit. And when we enter that presence, we will experience the abundant life. We'll be able to renew this mind. We'll be able to open that tap which blocks everything from heaven in our life and receive the victory. You know, my brothers and sisters, not being able to remember spiritual things is a condition or an indication of a hardened heart. You know, the disciples, before they were born again, before Jesus went to the cross, they had a hardened heart. Why? Because they were not born again. Jesus could not live inside their spirit. And you know, my brothers and sisters, some people say they can't remember scriptures. But they can remember all the movie stars in the movie. They can remember what their mother-in-law said. They can remember what their teacher said. They can remember all the negative things that people have said. You know, my brothers and sisters, it's not an issue of our memories not working correctly. It's the condition of our hearts. You must remember, people remember what is close to their heart. If somebody is really close to your heart, you will, even if that person is not with you, you will continue to remember them every day of your life. You'll continue to pray for them. You'll whisper a prayer for them. Their picture will come before you. You will continually imagine them even in your presence, even if they have passed away, because of that love, that relationship that you shared with somebody. And you know, my brothers and sisters, when Jesus is talking about not remembering spiritual things, The situation of the disciples was such in the old covenant that, because Jesus had still not gone to the cross, the situation was such that those disciples, because they were not born again, they had a hardened heart. They couldn't understand spiritual truths. Even though they saw those miracles, they saw Jesus performing those signs and wonders, the spiritual lessons behind that teaching, they still couldn't understand. And as a result, their hardened heart prevented them from understanding the spiritual lessons that Jesus was teaching them through these miracles that he was performing. Verse number 19. When I broke the 5 loaves for the 5,000, how many baskets full of broken pieces did you collect? He's asking them. They said to him, 12. You know, my brothers and sisters, what was Jesus talking about? This was about in Mark chapter 6. We are right now on Mark chapter 8. But in Mark chapter 6, if you read verses between 43 onwards, 40 Mark chapter 6, 40 onwards, there Jesus had performed a miracle where he had fed people with 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he had fed a multitude of 5,000 people, not including women and children. You know, in that particular gospel, they had taken 12 basketfuls of broken pieces of bread and of fish. And those who had eaten the loaves, they had numbered about 5,000 men. You know, my brothers and sisters, Jesus just didn't meet the need. You know, many times people think, you know, if I prepare the food, I have to prepare just about food so that there'll be no wastage of food. I just have to have everybody, you know, eating everything. Like, for example, you know, you go to some restaurants and you order a food, they will tell you, wait, we don't have anything ready. We have to prepare the food because we don't believe in any wastage. And so the time that you wait is much longer because they are preparing the food fresh for you on the spot. But there are some restaurants where everything is kept ready. As soon as the customer comes in, they are just able to mix it together. They are able to prepare it together and you are able to give you a very quick service. In the same way, my brothers and sisters, God is not a person who's only going to give you just about food that is enough for you. He's a God of abundance. Please understand, God doesn't just barely meet our needs. There was more food left over after everyone had eaten their fill than before the food was broken and distributed. What was there with Jesus in his hand? 5 loaves and 2 fish. 5 loaves and 2 fish. But when the miracle took place, what was left behind were 12 basketfuls of fragments of leftover food. You know, my brothers and sisters, our God is a God of abundance. That's what Jesus said in John 10:10. He said, the thief comes to kill, steal, and destroy. But I have come so that you may have life and have it to the fullest. You may have it in abundance. Remember, our God is not a God who's like a miser. He doesn't do just about giving you just to meet your needs. He's a God of abundance. His cup overflows, the one who really believes in the Lord. And we should remember this when reading scriptures like Matthew chapter 6 verse 33. What does Matthew chapter 6 verse 33 say? It says, seek first the kingdom of God and its righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. You know, my brothers, when we seek the kingdom of God, when we truly keep our focus on the kingdom of God in Matthew chapter 6 verse 33, the kingdom of God is the first thing that we need to keep our focus on. And when we keep our focus on the kingdom of God, all that is there in the kingdom just comes overflowing unto us. Unfortunately, we have a tendency to keep chasing the blessings, chasing on what we are going to receive. And as a result, we find that those things that we want to receive are going further and further away. We must remember, when we chase the blesser, blessings will come after us. The more we keep chasing the blessings will go further and further away from us. It is important for us to know the blesser, to know the author. And once we know the author, from the author, we can receive everything. And that's why Jesus said, the word of God tells us in the book of Hebrews, he's the author and finisher of our faith. You know, Jesus is the author and finisher of our faith. And so when we trust in him, when we believe in him, when we know that he is the one who gives us everything, that's the time, my brothers and sisters, we receive everything. Philippians 4:19. What does Philippians 4:19 says? My God, he says, St. Paul is writing to the Philippians, he's saying, my God will supply all your needs according to his unlimited riches in glory by Christ Jesus. You know, my brothers and sisters, our God is a God of abundance. Our God wants to let your cup overflow. He doesn't want to just give you barely meet your needs. If you are not living according to that overflow right now, it's not because God doesn't want to give you. Either, my brothers and sisters, you are not able to open the tap of your mind, you are not able to renew your mind, or you have truly not received the new birth. You know, my brothers and sisters, a hardened heart is a condition of a person who's truly not born again. Remember, this word of God has been written to our hearts. And the day we receive Christ, our hearts became the same as the heart of Jesus. Because that's what we have read in 1 John chapter 4 verse 17. As he is, So are we in this world. When we understand that the heart of Jesus and the heart of us becomes one on the day of our salvation, then brothers and sisters, this heart is able to receive this word of God. We will able to have that understanding of the word of God. And when we have the understanding of the word of God, that's the time we are going to receive everything that the word of God already confirms to us. You know, my brothers and sisters, in that crowd, on that particular day, there were women, there were children in that crowd. There were plenty of people. That means if Jesus fed 4,000 people and there were no women and children, there would surely have been anything between 10 to 15,000 people who ate from one little boy's lunchbox. Can you imagine? From a little boy's lunchbox of 7 loaves and a few fish on that particular day, Jesus was able to feed a multitude of anything between about 10 to 15,000 people. How? Because he took that bread and he multiplied it and he was compassionate to that people. And yet these disciples of his, when they had not taken bread on the boat, they were so much focused about not having bread to eat. They had become so spiritually dull. Their hearts were so hardened, knowing that their master could multiply and even provide them all their needs. Verse number 20. And the 7 for the 4,000, how many baskets full of broken pieces did you collect? And they said to him, 7. You know, my brothers and sisters, if we read Mark's gospel, Mark chapter 8, verses 5 to 9, because we have just finished that gospel last week. And you know, in Mark's gospel, chapter 8, verses 5 to 9, I want to just show you that because I've got it right here in front of me. In Mark's gospel, chapter 8, verses 5 to 9, we read, he asked them, how many loaves do you have? They said, 7. Then he ordered the crowd to sit down on the ground. And he took the 7 loaves and after giving thanks, he broke them and gave them to his disciples to distribute, and they distributed them to the crowd. They also had a few small fish, and after blessing them, he ordered that these 2 should be distributed. They ate and were filled and took up the broken pieces left over, 7 baskets full. Now there were about 4,000 people and he sent them away. You know, my brothers and sisters, Jesus had, after feeding 4,000 people with 7 loaves of bread, had more food for fewer people than the first time when he multiplied 5 loaves and had fed 5,000 people in Mark chapter 6 verses 38 to 44. You know, my brothers and sisters, this would have been a great opportunity for the disciples of Jesus to remember what he had done and suggest to their master and say, Lord, if you multiplied 5 loaves and 2 fish the first time, you multiplied 7 loaves and fed 4,000 people. Even though we are having just 1 loaf, I'm sure you can multiply this loaf and feed all of us. But you know, my brothers and sisters, these disciples, they just couldn't remember. They just couldn't even get this spiritual truth to their mind. And you know, they should have been suggesting to Jesus to multiply the loaf. If Jesus could do the greater miracle, surely just taking 1 loaf which they had with them on the boat and multiplying it for them to have bread to eat would have been no big deal for Jesus. You know, in Mark chapter 6 verse 44, the crowds were about 5,000, not including women and children. And in that case, in the other case, there were 4,000 men without including women and children. And in spite of the fact that Jesus had done this miracle on 2 occasions, my brothers and sisters, these disciples were still talking about not having bread to eat. You can imagine the dullness of these disciples. I mean, they were so spiritually blinded. They were so hardened, knowing that their master was no ordinary person. He had already done miracles and fed such a huge crowd. They should not even have been talking about the food. But that is exactly why they asked the question, because they were spiritually dull. They were hardened of heart. Verse number 21. Then he said to them, do you not yet understand? Do you not yet understand? You know, my brothers and sisters, if you read Matthew's gospel, Matthew chapter 16, verses 11 Matthew chapter 16, verses 11 to 12. I want to just take you there. Matthew chapter 16, verses 11 to 12. It says, "How could you fail to perceive that I was not speaking about bread? How could you fail to perceive that I was not speaking about bread? Beware of the yeast of the Pharisees and the Sadducees." Then they understood that he had not told them to beware of the yeast of bread, but of the teachings of the Pharisees and Sadducees. You know, my brothers and sisters, please understand about these disciples. You know, if you understand about the disciples' dullness, Jesus had, this whole topic is about Jesus warning them about false doctrines, warning them about false teaching. If you read the book of John, first book of John, in the first book of John chapter 4, it just begins. First John chapter 4, it talks about false prophets. It talks about the people who will come with false doctrines, will come with fables, they'll come with their own understanding and their own teaching in the last days. And you know, my brothers and sisters, right now, all that you are hearing right now, so many false doctrines have gone, so many people coming with their own theories about the word of God. You know, this is all being already told to us by Jesus, that in the last days, a lot of false prophets will go giving people false teachings and false doctrines. And Jesus is saying, beware of these false doctrines to his disciples 2000 years ago. If Jesus could warn his disciples 2000 years ago for the Pharisees and the religious system at that time, what about 2000 years later, my brothers and sisters? If we do not know this word, if we are not really focused on this word, none of us are studying this word, none of us are investing time to ask the Holy Spirit to give us understanding, how will we ever be able to get out of this bondage? It's a matter of our eternity, my brothers and sisters. It's a matter of our eternity. And if we only understand, if we only understand how serious this is, we will never ever take for granted the word of God. I want to just show you in Luke chapter 12, verse 1. Luke chapter 12, verse 1. "Meanwhile, when the crowds gathered by the thousands, so that they trampled on one another, he began to speak first to his disciples, 'Beware of the yeast of the Pharisees,'" that is their hypocrisy. You know, my brothers and sisters, these disciples remembered how many baskets of, you know, leftovers were there after those two miracles that Jesus had performed, feeding the crowds of people. But they had no spiritual insight from these experiences because of the hardness of their heart. Imagine, for on two different occasions, Jesus had fed people. One group was about 5,000, one group was about 4,000, not including women and children. If you consider the women and children in both the cases, on both occasions, it would have been anything between 10 to 12,000 people who ate that bread and ate that fish with a little amount, which was probably a tiffin of one of the boys who was present there. And yet, after he had done these two miracles, these disciples had no spiritual insight because of the hardness of their heart. They were not born again. Their spirits were still dead. And you know, my brothers and sisters, they failed to understand the spiritual lessons from the two miracles. They had information, but they had no spiritual perceptions. You know, that is exactly what happened. They could remember that there were 12 baskets left. There were 7 baskets left. All that information they had. But they couldn't understand the spiritual truths behind them. That's what a hardened heart does. You know, a hardened heart is of a person who cannot remember. It's a person who has still not been born again. And therefore, brothers and sisters, when we have not received the new birth, when we have not really accepted Christ, we have really not understood the reality of the cross, when we have not understood the price that was paid to set us free from hell and open heaven for us because of the blood of Jesus, our hearts will become hardened. We will find it so difficult to understand spiritual truths. And as a result, we need to take the immediate step of truly receiving Christ, understanding the reality of the cross, being born again, so that when we read this word under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit in us, who's already within us, he will give us, he'll be the best teacher. He'll open our eyes of our understanding. He'll open the eyes of our mind and give us the meaning of the word. He'll give us those spiritual truths. And therefore, brothers and sisters, it is important for us to have that understanding. And as the topic says, only believers can have understanding. Believers can understand the word of God because they cannot understand it on their own unless they are born again, unless the Spirit of God resides inside of us. And my brothers and sisters, you may hear a lot of preachers. You may hear a lot of teachers. You may hear a lot of people preaching the word of God. But whatever is being taught, if you can take it in, but once again, go back to the written word of God, hear it and see it for yourself in the word. Never take it as gospel truth, because many a times, if it is not confirmed by the written word of God, you are getting deceived. You are taking in false doctrines. You are taking in evil doctrines. You will stay in bondage for the rest of your life. You will never experience the victory. But if you really take the word of God, you really understand the word of God, then John 8:32 shall become a reality in your life and in my life. And what does Jesus say in John 8:32? He says, you shall know the truth. You shall know the truth. You shall know my word. You shall understand my word. And that word which you understood shall truly make you free. Amen. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you and we praise you once again for giving us the understanding of your word, helping us, Lord, through our new birth, through the presence of the Holy Spirit in us, to experience that life, that abundant life, that life of peace, that life of joy, that life where you have promised us to live here on earth as though we are in heaven. Because Lord, unless we experience that joy and peace in the Holy Spirit, unless we begin to experience that new life in Christ, we will only be deceiving ourselves, thinking that when we die, one day we will be with you. Yes, Lord, today through the understanding of your word, you have shown us that through our new birth, through the presence of the Holy Spirit inside of us, through the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit, we can live the victorious life that Jesus has already won for us. And for this understanding, we thank you and we praise you, Father, in the glorious and mighty name of Jesus. Amen.